Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 14th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I ask everyone to remember to turn off all electrical devices that might interfere with the sound system or turn them otherwise to silent. The first item is to take a decision by the committee to take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed on this?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, may I welcome our witnesses from Highlands and Islands Enterprise this morning. First of all, Charlotte Wright, Interim Chief Executive, and Forbes Duthie, Director of Finance and Corporate Services. Good morning to both of you. Now, no need to work the buttons. The sound desk will take care of that. And if you do want to come in, simply raise your hand or do so as you're able to. We'll start with a question from committee member Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, convener. Good morning.
Sorry. Apologies. I think Charlotte Wright has a brief opening statement, so perhaps you could give that first and then Gordon will ask his question.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to be before this committee. And particular thanks just to give this short statement, as I am aware that none of the members of the committee represent any part of the Highlands and Islands, so it is helpful just maybe to give you a little bit of background about the Highlands and Islands and the work of HAI. The region we represent, Highlands and Islands, is a diverse and beautiful region, and the economy and geography of our region present us with both challenges and great opportunities. The region covers half of the landmass of Scotland, but contains only 8% of the population. Therefore, the population is quite dispersed, apart from the main city of Inverness, which is a fast-growing city. We have over 100 inhabited islands. Some of those islands have residents of less than 100, for example, Fula, Papa Westray and Fair Isle. But I would emphasise in the 50 years since our predecessor HIDB was established, the significant progress that we have seen in the region, and particularly around that population growth. In the late 60s, when HIDB was formed, population was in absolute free fall, and that has been pretty much turned around. There are still some areas where that gives us cause for concern. In Argyll, there is still some loss of population, and in areas such as the Western Isles, whilst they have enjoyed some population growth, there is still a concern about the impacts there for working age and young people. So we aren't complacent about that continuing to be a challenge. Highlands and Islands Enterprise has a unique remit combining both social and economic development. We find that attracts a lot of interest from around the world, and we host a lot of visits to see what we do and how we do it in the Highlands and Islands. Our role is to deliver Scotland's economic strategy, and we do that through our four operational priorities, which contribute in turn to one or more of the four I's within Scotland's economic strategy, and I'll just very briefly describe those. We look at supporting businesses and social enterprises to achieve their growth aspirations. We do that through our account management approach and support over 400 businesses and over 50 social enterprises within our account management portfolio. So they receive tailored support through dedicated account managers who have access to a range of programmes and powers, including financial investment, programmes to support leadership and management, innovation, international trade, and a whole range there. And in deciding who is brought into account management, our choice there is about those that have the greatest opportunity to grow, and that will vary across the region in terms of size and scale. So in a fragile area, a business growing from 3 to 4 or 5 is as significant as one growing from 20 to 30, for example. We look at supporting the growth sectors. Our focus there is ensuring that we focus in on those which offer place-based distinctiveness, making the most of our assets, and which give us a competitive advantage and contribute to Scotland's economy. Just to give you some brief examples of those sectorally, in life sciences, we have LifeScan, a Johnson & Johnson company based in Inverness, which employs over 1,000 people We've recently supported them with research and development, which is helping to anchor that significant company within the Highlands and Islands, focusing all of its diabetes research in Scotland. We also have the world's leading chemical company, BASF, based on the west coast of Lewis, perhaps not the obvious place where you would expect to see such a company operating, but they bought over a small business which we had supported for a number of years, who produce a very high quality omega-3 fatty acid. We own the site there and investing in that site, which has enabled BASF to currently employ over 70 people at much higher than the average wage. And with the site investment, that will grow to over 90. Compare that to that kind of impact in a city, and that would be equal to many thousands of jobs and is really significant in that part of the Western Isles. Food and drink is clearly an important sector in the Highlands and Islands. I'd maybe just flag up aquaculture as an example. We've currently been supporting the industry, who have devised a new strategy to lead aquaculture through to 2030 and develop a new industry leadership group. There are some great opportunities there to increase the productivity of aquaculture, but also for us to support a growing indigenous supply chain in that sector. In tourism, naturally a focus on the natural environment and our culture and heritage, but we see world-leading niche tourism businesses in areas such as adventure tourism and marine tourism, again, building on the assets of our region. Energy is clearly critically important to us. We're delighted to see that the wind towers plant in Kintyre, which is an area which has had problems and challenges, taken over by Korean company CS Wind. Again, they are investing and protecting employment in that fragile area. And great news to see in the Pentland Firth, Maygen now generating electricity from the world's first commercial scale tidal array. Creative industries is a vibrant sector in the Highlands and Islands. Our focus there is around music, fashion and textiles, which come together in the international showcase, which is Expo North. And in business services, there isn't a financial services sector in the Highlands and Islands. We've developed a niche in business process outsourcing with a number of key companies operating there. For example, Capgemini, who in fact now occupy High's former office in Inverness and are expanding there. Our third operational priority is around strengthening communities, and that's where we bring together that social and economic remit. And the work that we do in strengthening communities is central to High's inclusive growth approach. We support creative, capable, sustainable communities by supporting them to own and manage income-generating assets to develop both services and employment locally. We also use our account manage approach with communities and have that relationship with around 50 communities and 115 community organisations to extend that reach. Our fourth priority area is around creating the conditions for a competitive region. That's a focus on some of our main infrastructure investments, the key one of which at the moment is the delivery of the £146 million investment to roll out next generation broadband in the Highlands and Islands. And without this programme, led by High in partnership with BT, supported both by Scottish and UK governments, next generation broadband would only reach in the low 20s% of population across the Highlands and Islands. When this programme is completed in towards spring next year, that will have reached 86% of the population, making a significant difference. However, the work doesn't stop there, because the key thing is realising the benefit of that investment in digital skills and digital businesses operating effectively. Other examples will include the development of the Inverness campus, a flagship investment in the region's capital. We also are extending our reach for higher education in the region. We have been a long-term supporter of the University of the Highlands and Islands, having finally got a university in the region and are currently working with them on a new School of Health project. However, there are a number of other universities operating in the Highlands and Islands. For example, the world-renowned Glasgow School of Art has opened a campus in Moray, which would be fantastic to see students having the opportunity to access Glasgow School of Art from the Highlands. And we're also capitalising on the presence of Heriot Watt University in Stromness and Orkney alongside the European Marine Energy Centre to focus on energy developments. A couple of final things I'd just like to mention. Firstly, the Audit Scotland report, a report that we very much welcomed and noted that it stated that HIE is performing well with a clear, well evidence-based strategy and positive attitude to risk. Naturally, there were some recommendations, and we are actively addressing those recommendations, which are specific to HIE. And on the same note, on the Enterprise and Skills Review, we equally welcome the opportunity to positively shape and influence the next steps as that review process moves into phase two. And finally, Convener, I'd just like to welcome any member of the committee, or indeed the committee itself, to come to the Highlands and Islands to see any of the projects or the work of HIE, and we'd be delighted to host you. Thank you.
Right, thank you very much, Charlotte. Just to note at this stage also, we have apologies from committee member Andy Whiteman. Now we'll come to our first question.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. And thanks very much for those opening remarks. I was wanting to ask you about comments that were made by Mackay Consultants to their written evidence to the enterprise review that's currently taking place. And they've said, I believe that Scottish Enterprise and the Highlands and Islands Enterprise have generally made very good use of their budgets, but their contribution to Scotland's economic performance has declined recently, particularly that of HIE. And it goes on to say, indeed, it could be argued that both Scottish Enterprise and HIE have become too risk-averse in recent years and that their failure rates could have been higher. So just wondering what your views of that's.
So I mentioned just at the end of my remarks there, Audit Scotland's comment about a positive attitude to risk. And I think it is critically important for an economic development agency to have the right approach to risk. I wouldn't say that we are risk averse. We are certainly risk aware, but we do take risk. We have had business failure and project failure, and we would exactly agree with that in terms of without taking risk, you're not going to get failure at all. But we see our approach to risk as being clear at the outset what that risk is and making sure that our process can put in place mitigation as we work through it. But certainly we have some excellent examples of where we have taken that risk. And in fact, next generation broadband implementation is one. Working with a commercial partner to invest £146 million is actually a challenging process. Through that procurement, we only had one bidder at the end of that procurement process. It is a real challenge to make sure that you get both the value for money and the innovation through that implementation in those circumstances. And certainly, there are a range of things that we've done across the Highlands and Islands where that risk has occasionally crystallised and that we have seen write-offs in investments in businesses and otherwise. When it comes to infrastructure development, perhaps another example would be our £5 million investment into the £10 million project at Lough Boisdale. The community came to us and said, could we support them with £2 million towards a £4 million development? And we said, no. Why don't you make it a £10 million development and we'll support you with £5 million? And I think that was about pushing the risk and ambition. So I could give you a number of examples.
Well, one of the other comments that was in submissions from a different company is my experience is that their funding is somewhat randomly distributed and only to larger organisations.
Certainly, I would refute that with relation to Highlands and Islands Enterprise. I mean, we work with a range of company sizes, and I think I mentioned in my opening remarks that some of them are very small, employing less than five people within organisations. So, yes, whilst we've got those big companies such as LifeScan, we work with a range of very small ones, and some of our interventions are in the single thousands of pounds to support those companies.
One of the points you raised at the beginning was about the depopulation of the Highlands and how that's been reversed, etc. But in terms of economic development, is there still difficulty where there's a lack of people and lack of skills in order to grow sectors? And where would you see the economic... We know across Scotland economic hotspots are predominantly Aberdeen and Edinburgh, but in your area of Hy, where would the economic hotspots be?
Yeah, so the first part of that, except that is a challenge in terms of skills and talent attraction. Jointly with Skills Development Scotland, we developed a skills investment plan for the region, and part of that is a talent attraction plan, which we are leading on for exactly that reason. Most businesses that we speak to will raise the challenge of getting the right skills or indeed getting the right people into the area. So actively it is important to the Highlands and Islands to bring both people and the right skills into the region. That might not be the same as the rest of Scotland overall. So absolutely we see that as really important. In terms of economic hotspots, well, I guess the city of Inverness would stand out there as one that has made significant difference to the performance of the region overall. It has been the UK's fastest growing city, and we really see the benefit of that. Our job is to make sure that the success of Inverness is pushed out and that we have an inclusive approach to ensure that we want to see that growth operating effectively across the whole of our region, from Unstone, Shetland to Campbelltown in Argyll.
Okay, thanks so much.
Could I just do a follow-up question, perhaps? Do you think that the attitudes are risk-averse in terms of the people in the Highlands and Islands who are looking to go into business?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it is probably something that we do see. And maybe an indicator of that is businesses accessing finance at the moment. We undertake a panel survey on a regular basis with businesses across the Highlands and Islands, and there are a few key questions that we revisit there, including access to finance, and a finding that businesses are much more reluctant to go and borrow capital at the moment, even though banks are apparently willing to lend and that there are other sources of finance available. So I think we really do see that, and that is an area where through account management we're working really closely with businesses. They do need to continue to invest and develop to continue that growth. So I think that is characterised there.
Thank you. Richard Leonard.
Yeah, the exercise this morning is part of our budget scrutiny, and my question really is both to Forbes Duthie and Charlotte Wright, but I reflect that the last time Charlotte Wright was here at the committee on the 1st of November, we had a discussion about the funding as outlined in the Audit Scotland report, and I think what you'd said, Charlotte Wright, was that you believe there was a rebalancing between granting aid funding and special project funding. I mean, as I look at the figures last year to this year, there have been further declines in your grant in aid funding. I mean, do you have an understanding of what the Scottish Government's policy on this is? Is it their policy to move away from grant in aid funding and look towards special project funding as a matter of policy?
So Forbes will, I'm sure, come in. So we have seen over recent years that we've had the ability to increase our budget by specific ring-fenced amounts for certain projects. So Wave Energy Scotland is a good example, Community Broadband and Scottish Land Fund, which we deliver on behalf of Scotland, have given us the ability to increase the amount of resource that we're able to deploy overall.
I think it's a fair observation to say that over the last 10 years, our grant in aid has been a bit volatile. I think it's a fair description of what's happened. That's happened for a number of particular reasons, and some of them indeed have been government funding available. And we've been through these reviews before, and we used to have the quinquennial review where every 5 years they reviewed the role of enterprise agencies, and those have always resulted in some sort of grant in aid movement. I think the most important aspect in terms of actually how we manage our grant in aid is that we because we've been living in this environment, we do have an ability to flex the budget within a certain extent in terms of how we work with our customers and our clients, and indeed Scottish Government. And that's why you'll see it a much bigger element of Scottish Government funding, as you would perhaps call ring-fence projects, coming through now, because we actively go out and pursue those as specific projects where we know that Scottish Government funding is available to support them. And you can see that through broadband and the WES initiatives as well, which are particularly important to the Highlands, but also obviously very important to Scotland, particularly in terms of wave energy and how that may well be developed and evolved. The one important thing I think Charlotte mentioned as well is that digital connectivity is primary importance actually to make sure that the Highlands and Islands are connected. And that as I always tend to say, is that the technology eliminates distance. So if you're in, you know, Papa Westray or wherever, if you've got a good digital link, you can actually limit that, then actually start to have some sort of business scope. Obviously, you need the rest of the infrastructure in terms of developing that. But as we sit here, we had a paper at our leadership team yesterday, which, yes, we spent $146 million on broadband to date, or the process of closing that project. And that's going to get us up to 86% coverage. It's going to take at least another $150 million to get us to 95% coverage. And then it's the incremental cost of that final distance, which just reminds us of the cost of remote and rural communities and need to get to that. So in terms of what we need, I think, you know, yes, it's good to have those ring fence projects, but it's also good to have a good solid grant and aid base that we can build on and actually have that discretion to invest where we need and see the priorities locally. So as we look towards the budget, yeah, I hope that there's an element of grant and aid increase. Whether that achieves, I don't know. I'm looking forward to next week to finding out. you know, I'm not completely unrealistic, perhaps, but there is also a scope for budget cuts. I do live in the real world in that respect too, but we don't quite know yet. But we're looking forward to finding out.
Can I just interrogate a couple of the lines of the budget which appear in your Appendix 1 as part of your submission? Forbes Duffy, you're saying there that the marginal cost of broadband investment will increase as you try to install it in the more difficult to reach areas, but yet your budget between 15-16 and 16-17 on broadband investment went down from 30.9 million to 21.4 million.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's because that's coming to the end of phase one. We haven't got phase two funding yet. That's a project we need to discuss with Scottish Government. And that's what we're starting to see. That's why we had that particular paper yesterday. It's that's moving to phase two. That is the final element of actually getting to the 86% target. The next funding, we haven't actually got in any budget plan yet. That's where we're working with Scottish Government to see what they can fund with us.
Do you have any early indications of what the budget for 17-18 is going to be for broadband investment?
There's talk about potentially £400 million allocation being available in the Scottish Government, but that's sort of second hand hearsay that we've got. We haven't actually seen the budget papers or anything that would suggest that's there or not.
So that relates to the government's commitment to the 100% coverage. So we are completing the project that we had, which takes us to the 86% coverage. The government is then deciding what they're going to do about honouring their 100% commitment, and at this point we've yet to determine what High's role will be in that with government.
Okay, thank you. Just a couple of short questions on two of the budget lines. First of all, on European funds, again, looking at the years outlined in this appendix between 15-16, the budget and the outturn, there seems to be a considerable drop in expenditure derived from European funds, presumably. And if I'm looking at the 2016-17 original plan versus full year forecast, there's an even greater drop in European funding. Could you explain the reasons for that?
I think the reason is quite similar. The majority of the European programmes are now coming to an end in the current phase. Obviously, we're putting funding forward for the next phase, and that's to reflect the inevitable tail off that we've had. The projects are now coming to fruition, they're coming to close, and that's really why you see that drop off emerging.
Budgeting for 5 million, and actually you're likely to spend 1 million. So presumably when you made your budget, you had an idea of whether things were coming to an end or not?
We did, but I suspect what we actually did was we normally just have a 5 million line, because European funding can be quite volatile in that respect in terms of the projects that are coming forward and not always at our own hands, so we don't have the control of when these projects are made. So we try to get in European funds of 5 million, but it doesn't often, if projects aren't actually out there to try and develop that from the private sector, and then it's hard to actually deliver that.
There's no blockage in the system.
There's no blockage in the system that is causing an artificial situation in terms of slowing things down. It's actually just genuine projects and coming to fruition.
Final quick question, if I may. Looking at the investment line, you're forecasting investment expenditure down by about 20% this year compared to last year. Again, perhaps could you reflect to us the reasons why you think that is?
I think the reality of the investment is that just demonstrates the sort of flexibility that we have within the budget available. As the budget flexes, because we start off, we have the operating plan, which is a 3-year document, so that's a figure you would initially see. Then we go into the actual operating plan itself for that particular year, and as you see, there was a 3 million drop in our grant and aid this year. So we had to reflect that, and that's the way we then move that forward. And some projects inevitably ebb and flow in terms of the things we've got. For instance, we've got as you mentioned, the broadband project that slips and slides, and also we have a very big project with Norbord out in the in Mary Firth, and again that's an £8 million project, and again that's moving. So that enables our budget to move, and we can manage that in a positive or negative way depending on the resources we've got available at a particular time.
Sorry, just one final question. I mean, you talk about volatility and ebb and flow, but as I look at these figures, they're all going downwards, aren't they? You start with your operating planned budget in 15-16 of £27.3 million worth of investment. Mm. Your outturn is 23.6. Your budget for this year was 21.3. You're forecasting 18.8. That's not volatility up and down. That's down, isn't it?
It is down, yes. And that reflects, obviously, as you'll see, that there's a reduction there in European funding there as well. So we didn't spend the European projects that were initially thought of there didn't spend, because European funding matches spend. So that we will see if the European funds are down by 2.5 million, so would the investment funds be down by 2.5 million as well, because they're not matching off.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Good morning. I have a couple of questions relating to the forthcoming budget. You mentioned, Charlotte, the Audit Scotland report. And just looking at that, so they say the full range of public sector support for businesses is not known, which creates a risk of duplication and inefficiency. Public sector support is not well understood by businesses, and there is scope to simplify arrangements and clarify roles and responsibilities. So my question is, do you know what analysis is being done to rectify that, as presumably there's a danger that the Scottish Government is unable to accurately assess the value add of HIE, and that could have a negative impact on your budget going forward?
I have to say, in discussions with Audit Scotland, we did actually push back on some of those statements, as we didn't recognise those remarks in terms of being able to establish what is there in terms of our expenditure, or indeed that is not able to be known. So we did actually push back on that. I think it is quite clear, and that's in all of our operational documents. We also didn't fully recognise the remarks about whether businesses found that difficult as well, and did push back to Audit Scotland on that area. However, we'd certainly recognise that if there's feedback from business about being able to articulate more clearly how they navigate their way through the business and enterprise skills system, then it is really important that we listen to that and make sure that is as clearly articulated as possible. It is really important to us that businesses and community can well understand what we do, why we do it, and how we do it.
Do you think the Scottish Government understands that, your pushback, such that, because presumably it's as important that the Scottish Government, when it's budgeting, understands that you've pushed back and made that clear?
Yeah, indeed, and I think they do fully understand how we use our budget and what we are doing with that, and have a close relationship with our sponsor team in understanding that.
And just following on from that, so again looking at the Audit Scotland report, so they say despite the enterprise body's budget reductions since 2008-09, there's little change in Scottish Government's expectations on you, which creates a risk that your resources are spread too thinly. What was your response to that, and what impact does your answer have on your requirements from this year's budget?
So in terms of, yes, I guess there's always an increased or increasing expectation of what we can achieve, and we would hold that ambition internally as well. I think it is important that we continue to make sure that we wring every ounce of value out of every penny that we spend, and we'd see that as our job to do that. Yes, I guess that becomes tougher when we've had some pressure on budgets, and indeed when we've seen some of the challenges and opportunities that face our business and communities that we really want to be able to respond to and lead on. So I guess that's a question of choices for us in terms of prioritisation and how we manage that. In relation to what we'd like to see as budget settlements next week, then, in reality, of course, we'd love to see an increase because we could well use any additional resources and have a list of ambitious projects and support to businesses that we'd like to implement. As Forbes mentioned, in reality, I think we would find at least the same settlement as this year is a good outcome.
Right. Thank you for your answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian Martin.
I'd like to move on to your relationship with Highlands and Islands University. You have said that you're doing work with the university to increase innovation with your account-managed companies with the university. Can you give me some detail on that and what those projects are?
So we do. So just focusing in for a second on the University of the Highlands and Islands, which at the growth of the University of Highlands and Islands has been hand in hand with that of High and also the growth of the region overall. So a particular project, for example, that we're working at the moment is a health and wellbeing pilot, which has come out of the work of the Scotland Can Do Forum in terms of innovation. And that's offering up some really interesting opportunities for businesses working in the digital health space, along with NHS and the universities working together. And that's a key focus for us in the Highlands, so that we can see the opportunity to deliver healthcare to remote and rural areas, and the role that some small businesses with innovative approach to digital health are able to play into that space and hits that innovation agenda overall. The university provides a range of support to business and are very keen to respond to us. For example, in I mentioned earlier the work that the aquaculture sector is doing on setting out their strategy through to 2030. So we've talked to the UHI about the opportunities to deliver into some of the skills gaps that have been recognised by that industry, for example, in fish husbandry and other areas.
You mentioned sort of skills gaps, and obviously one of the issues for rural areas is actually having the labour force to actually plug those skills gaps. What are you doing there with the university in terms of, so for example, you've got a huge potential in your area. You mentioned tidal energy, some massive projects happening there, but largely largely driven by companies out with Scotland, you know, investing in our natural resources. What are you doing to increase innovation there and plug some skills gaps that are actually going to be able to drive that industry forward?
So I mentioned in relation to the European Marine Energy Centre in Orkney, where we have Heriot Watt University. They have been there for a number of years, and the development of a campus in Stromness, which will bring together the academic expertise and research and development capability of Heriot Watt, sitting alongside the actual piloting and deployment of marine and tidal devices into EMEX test facilities. So that is a real living laboratory out in the sea and the coast of Orkney, which is really fulfilling that, and that is absolutely cutting edge innovation. EMEC is the world's only grid-connected tidal test station, and is something that we have a real great opportunity to grow. As well as looking at that, they're looking at the development of hydrogen capture and storage, again, really leading the way globally. They are absolutely inundated from visitors all around the world who want to learn from what has been done in EMEC. In terms of skills gaps, generally, absolutely, both with universities and colleges and working with SDS and Business Direct, an area that I would highlight, I think, would be digital skills. I don't think that's unique to the Highlands and Islands. It's something, as we see, as a challenge in the 21st century to ensure that all of our businesses can operate as digital businesses. It also means for remote and rural areas of the Highlands and Islands that anybody can then work from those areas and link in and sell to the world. But we need to have first the capability and capacity of next generation broadband, but we need to have the skills. So we're also working on a project which is part of the Inverness City deal for a science skills academy, and see fantastic potential for that, particularly reaching into young people. So throughout the summer, that's run a number of coding clubs and some of those types of events that I'm sure you're aware of, which help build that interest in the next generation on what we can do with digital skills and really build that in at the outset. That's been taking place actually within the building that we occupy in the Inverness campus, and fantastic to see just the huge amount of enthusiasm from young people there. We also, within our building in High, have a digital marketing suite. We've had over 1,500 businesses through that Hello Digital facility, as we call it, which have been able to demonstrate both to businesses and to the wider public things like virtual reality, use of drones, and a whole amount of events which excite and interest people's interests and the opportunity in that arena.
You've mentioned about retaining talent in the area, and obviously universities help you retain that talent. People don't leave to go to other universities. That's a big part of that as well. But one of the issues, as you've mentioned, the population is quite low compared to other parts of Scotland. How important is... I'll rephrase that. What do you see has been the impact of the Brexit situation with regard to that, and actually having the labour force for all these fantastic opportunities that you are developing in Highlands and Islands, and actually having them staffed and managed?
Yes. So in talking to businesses, a concern about the impact of Brexit on particularly EU nationals who work within sectors, particularly tourism and food and drink, which are very highly reliant on those individuals, is absolutely a concern. Many of those industries do really rely on that manpower. And in fact, that is the history of both food and drink and tourism across the Highlands and Islands. Whilst it is predominantly European migrants at the moment, in the past that has been from all around the world. Australia, New Zealand and other places have helped us support some of those key industries. So we're working with businesses, firstly to reassure them in the short term of the situation. And also, I think your point about how we deal with our population challenges, one aspect of that is also to make sure that we continue to create opportunities for our own young people to want to stay, to live, work and study in the Highlands and Islands. So we undertake a youth survey. We've done that twice now with a five-year gap in between it. And the last survey showed actually a marked difference in the attitudes of the young people in the Highlands and Islands to what they thought about living and working in the Highlands and Islands, and in a very positive sense, where they have a massive sense of pride and commitment to belonging from the Highlands and Islands, but specifically that they are much more optimistic about the opportunities both to study and to take up employment opportunities in the Highlands and Islands. And that's something which was great news to us, and I think we really need to make sure that we capitalise on by continuing to work on these opportunities both within further and higher education, but particularly about employment prospects. I'd have to say maybe there's a wider context there, economic context, because for that to all work properly, there are other elements which are equally important. So, for example, when we met with our board with a group of businesses in Aviemore as part of their high board work, we had a 50 at a business breakfast. The key things that came out of that discussion for them that they were concerned about in the economy were about housing, roads and connectivity, and it's that whole package which is important to young people as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks, convener. Earlier on you mentioned how good it was to have these high quality jobs, and I think that was an overseas owner in the west coast of Lewis. So can you tell us how do you balance up between, you know, any jobs and good jobs, and I don't know if there's such a thing as a bad job. And for example, ownership, does ownership matter? Would community ownership be something that you feel is important, and what are you doing about that?
Yeah, okay. So it's absolutely fantastic to see businesses which can offer significant wage rates and particularly opportunities which really maximise the use of skills, and certainly BASF that I mentioned on West Coast of Lewis is a great example for being able to do that. However, that is there because a local entrepreneur started off trying to use the skills that he and a small group of people had, which went on to this high-profile omega-3 fatty acids enzyme that they worked on, which became a target for investment for BASF. So really, the fact that we have BASF now looking to provide 90 jobs on the west coast of Lewis is actually based on long-term investment that we made in a small company, an indigenous company, which went on to grow. And we would not have been able to achieve that significant growth without that further investment, which has come from an international company. However, I mean, those examples, to be honest, within the Highlands are fewer and far between. And really, the meat and drink, if that's not a pun, in terms of our food and drink industry, is about small companies which are indigenous, which are growing and adding two or four people to their employees overall. They can make significant differences, particularly in our rural areas. In terms of good and bad jobs, well, so long as we clearly making sure that we've got employment is the most important thing that we can see. Where we can influence that in terms of wage rates and what those employers do is really important to us as well. I think you also mentioned community ownership. Clearly, that's something we've worked with and have a fantastic track record in terms of the community ownership, both of land and assets. And to support that, many of those communities create important jobs within their communities in managing, owning and developing those assets. And some of them are very successful in what they do.
Do you have a particular angle on who should own a project or a business, or is it really just what's appropriate for that particular business? And another one in there would be, you know, would you be encouraging women to own and run businesses and set up businesses?
Yeah, so I think in terms of the ownership, yes, I think you're absolutely right that it is what is appropriate. And that might change over time, as in my example of BASF in the west coast of Lewis, coming from a small business run by an entrepreneur into what is now part of a multinational company. So that is really about making sure that we can support the growth of a business, and it may go through those changes as part of its own life cycle. In terms of your question about women, yes, we are working really hard to support that, working with Women's Enterprise Scotland and our own work on equality to try and influence that. To be fair, I think there's still a long journey to go there in seeing the kind of improvement that we'd like to see overall. We do see that there is a difference between the social enterprise world and business in terms of where women stand and the numbers in terms of management overall. So I think we provided some figures to the committee which set that out.
I mean, you've stressed the whole thing about social development and strengthening communities, which I think is unique to HIE as compared to, say, Scottish Enterprise. I mean, you know, a cynic might say, well, why do we need to strengthen communities in the Highlands and forget about the ones in Fife or somewhere else? How would you answer that kind of question? Why is there a need, and what difference are you making?
Well, so HIGB and then HI were set up to deal with the specific challenges of the Highlands and Islands. And while, granted, there are other parts of Scotland which are rural, the Highlands and Islands is really quite unique in terms of its geography, its islands, and its remote mainland populations on remote peninsulas as well. So that for many of those communities, the opportunity of ownership of their own assets and supporting those communities is absolutely integral to that economic development. And we see that they go critically hand in hand. By creating those small job opportunities, you're investing in those communities. By those communities working to retain and develop local services, for example, social care, the one shop on an island, they are also important to the fabric of life. And without people having that community facility, they would have a difficulty in being able to have a full and sustaining life.
Okay. I'm also on the Rural Economy Committee, and we've been looking at crofting a bit, and our understanding is that some time ago responsibility for developing crofts was switched over to HIE, but there's some feeling it should go back to the Crofting Commission, because HIE have not created many crofts, and surely crofts would be part of developing a community.
So our role in crofting is actually quite narrow in its relation to the development of the crofting township. So it's quite specific there. What we are doing is working, particularly again in those community landowners owned territories, to encourage them either to look at new croft entrants, and we have seen that in some of those communities where they own the land, or new farms as well where that's appropriate.
Okay, and the final one, which was also linked to evidence we had at the Rural Economy Committee, was that I asked somebody last week, we had Community Broadband Scotland there, you know, they seemed to be satisfied, or there was some satisfaction if a village got connected, presumably through fibre, but they didn't seem to be too worried if, say, the richer people in the village can afford it and the poorer people in the village can't afford it. Does that come in with HIE's remit?
I suppose in terms of our rollout of the broadband contract that I talked about, then that's within the work we do with BT. In relation to Community Broadband Scotland, some of those solutions will be very unique and bespoke and can have, I guess, some challenges about how they are delivered overall. I think our point here is about making sure that that is inclusive and equal as possible. I think I'd have to follow up with CBS to see exactly what was meant by the feedback that you were just giving.
But when you're using a word like inclusive, so you are wanting, you would see it as part of your vision that everybody would be able to connect.
And indeed the Scottish Government's commitment is to that 100% target.
But is the 100% target just mean it's in the village, or does it mean that every person in the village is connected?
Just to make sure I'm clarifying this, so that what we're doing at the moment will take us to 86%, and that is the end of that programme. Scottish Government have then made a commitment which is around about 100%, and they are working on that at the moment. We have yet to determine what HI's role or CBS's role would be in that final 14%.
I mean, I don't want to be pedantic, but does 86% mean that 86% of people are actually connected in their houses?
Yes.
Or does it just mean there's a cabinet nearby?
86% of population.
Are actually connected, right. Okay, thanks so much.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. Good morning. When you last came in to appear before the committee, phase one of the Skills and Enterprise review had just been announced, and you said that you welcomed the opportunity to have strategic oversight across the agencies, but we have yet to see exactly what this will mean for the boards of the individual agencies. Since then, there has been a statement made by the government that a strategic board will replace individual agency boards while each of the agencies will retain their individual legal status. Can I get your understanding as to how this might work and what issues or concerns you might have that the individual boards of the agency, such as HIE, with their very different remits, might be replaced by one overarching board?
Yes. So, I mean, we are still, I suppose, waiting to hear some more detail from Scottish Government about the actual implementation of Phase 2. As he indicated, I think we really welcome that Phase 2 will be done in a different way than Phase 1, which will include much more input from the agencies who were part of that review, and really welcome that as an opportunity to influence and shape what that looks like going forward. So in terms of the question of the board, and there has been a fairly strong reaction across the Highlands and Islands to a message that there would no longer be a high board as we understand it at the moment. I think for us what is critically important is that we are able to articulate the benefit and input and the role that the High Board has taken over that last 50 years going to back to HIDB, and the role that they have played in the progress of the region, and ensure that in whatever is to come, and I'm fairly sure that there will need to be some kind of arrangements that will sit below that statutory board, that ensures that we retain those important and essential ingredients that have contributed proactively and positively to the progress of the region.
Yeah, thank you. And just to follow up on that, what would you say the main, the principal distinctive features of the High Board are in comparison with the boards of the other agencies?
I mean, I can only really speak about the way the High Board operates, and I don't have detailed knowledge of how the others operate. I mean, in terms of part of the executive of HIE, I think we found that the High Board have been very, very beneficial to us in their role in helping us prioritise where we implement strategy across the Highlands and Islands. Their own knowledge and expertise from the walks of life that they come and their insight into the Highlands and Islands. And in particular, the way that we operate is when the High Board meets, we ensure that they spend a fair amount of their time actually meeting and engaging with businesses and communities in the Highlands and Islands so that they are part of the visible base of High, and that is recognised and appreciated by the communities that we work with, and that they have the opportunity to talk to the High Board, to influence the High Board, and ensure that we recognise the challenges and opportunities that are facing them.
Okay. Thank you. Just on a slightly different area, your paper highlights opportunities in tourism, food and drink, and other areas going forward. In terms of the impact of Brexit and the opportunities that might arise from that, can you talk us through the steps HIE are taking to explore those opportunities and help companies that you assist in looking to capture those opportunities?
Yes, so certainly in relation to tourism, all indications would be that this year has been an extremely good year for tourism, and clearly that's related to a couple of things which do have a Brexit link, so that for visitors from overseas, we have looked like a more attractive location in terms of how far their money goes. And I think we've also seen more people choosing to holiday near home rather than going away. So working with tourism businesses, many of whom have felt challenged in terms of being able to cope with some of that capacity, that produces challenges, say, for islands in terms of making sure that ferries are at full capacity to get everybody across to the islands to enjoy that boom. So a fair bit of work with tourism businesses. Going back to digital as well, that's making sure that they are fully utilising their digital capabilities, both in terms of marketing, but being able to transact fully with tourists using digital means. Food and drink clearly is benefiting from the export potential. So in the short term, our work is alongside SDI in maximising that opportunity, but also taking the longer-term view about what other markets out with the EU could be targeted for the future, and working on strategies to maximise opportunities there. We spoke earlier this morning also about the potential impact on workforce and making sure that businesses have in place strategies for developing, maintaining their workforce is really critical too.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Gil Patterson.
Thanks very much. Just touching on exports, I wonder how many more new exporters are there in your area since last year, and how does the HIE budget help support increased exports?
So in terms of our account managed businesses, I think we have see at the moment a further 20% who are looking at exporting for the first time. So that is really important to see that that is growing. We have a programme, International Highlands and Islands, which we're operating to bring as many new exporters into the whole internationalisation agenda. That can be quite a slow process. So the first time a business considers looking at exporting can take up to 5 years before they are fully transacting internationally, and we need to work through a series of supports to make sure that the right choices are made in terms of market, product and capability so that people can absolutely maximise those opportunities.
I think you've already mentioned one company. I take it the BASF product is really an export.
It is. It's almost entirely for the Japanese market, where there is a strong interest in the omega-3 fatty acids. So that is amazing to see, again, for that part of the Western Isles, where you have a substantial high-value product that is entirely going into an overseas market in Japan.
General comments that you can mention on specific new export companies exporting?
New opportunities?
New ones that have already happened since last year.
Since last year. So let me think of some examples. So we've seen a lot of growth recently in terms of micro distilleries and breweries. So a range of quite exciting developments. I was on Isle of Harris last week. Isle of Harris Distillery, a significant investment near Tarbert. Their whisky isn't ready yet, but their gin is, and they've got a fantastic, it's great product, and they are seeing fantastic traction with that gin overseas, and already, whilst their whisky isn't ready, they pre-sold quite a lot of barrels into their second phase, which isn't even barreled yet, and their first phase is fully sold out. Also in terms of beer, we've seen huge growth for new markets in micro distilleries and micro breweries. So Black Isle Brewery, for example, has been reaching out to US and other markets. So there is some really great opportunity out there.
It's funny you talking about these issues. I'm a lifelong teetotaler. However, I support the industry quite considerably. But it then leads to another question. I think you, John Mason, touched on it, and I wonder what emphasis and importance that you put in the prospect of exporting and perhaps against companies that maybe have no opportunity, no interest in exporting, but might be the prospect for the importance to the community by actually assisting them to maybe just to sustain the community or help it to grow. Have you got a judgment to make there, or have you got an emphasis?
Well, if a business is able to expand its markets, and naturally if the market is only Highlands and Islands or Scotland, then that is immediately limited, so that any business that has significant growth aspirations will need to look at how it develops its market. Now, the rest of UK might be a great place for a business to start in going on that journey. But as I said earlier, we need to work out a really clear strategy with a business so that they make the right decisions. But I also thought it might be useful to give perhaps what you could term the flip side of that. And I mentioned aquaculture earlier, and one of the opportunities that we've worked through with the industry leadership there is the place of the supply chain in aquaculture. So as you're probably aware, the leading producers in aquaculture are mostly Norwegian, and a lot of the supply chain, therefore, is actually Norwegian as well. There are great opportunities there for some of that supply chain to be filled by Indigenous businesses. So the flip side of what we're doing on exporting is also, what are our opportunities in import substitution, and how do we see those as great opportunities for our strong Indigenous companies, which still support, ultimately, in my aquaculture example, increasing productivity and value from what is an important sector to us in aquaculture, but brings a more a local supply chain into play.
My question should have been more pointed. Would you make an emphasis on an exporter or someone that wasn't exporting but actually delivering
in a
community that needs either to be sustained?
Sorry,
that's
so dense. I didn't understand what you were getting at with your question. No, the answer is no. Clearly we want to increase exports overall, but business growth is a critical thing for us. So if we're looking at opportunities, and particularly, say, for our remote and rural areas, if a business has got the opportunity to grow, and that growth is based on markets within the Highlands and Islands and Scotland, then that is absolutely important to us.
That's good. Thanks for that.
Jackie Bailey?
Yep. I wonder whether I could follow up on exports, because you've talked about your ambition and aspiration. I'm curious to know how many account-managed companies are currently exporting in your portfolio, how many you expect next year, and whether you've set any kind of internal target for that. And I suppose the piece that goes with that is how much budget you actually devote to this as a percentage of your total budget, and whether there are constraints within budget to you realising your ambition.
So I might not be able to give you detailed figures on all of those, and we'll come back to anything that I can't answer off the top of my head. But 57% of our account managed portfolio of 401 businesses, 455 of whom include social enterprises, are currently exporting, and a further 20% are starting that process. So we can see that there is a growth trajectory there. In terms of growth for next year, a lot of that will be realising that ambition of the 20% who are starting the export journey, although we will continue to try and grow the top of that funnel, if you like, so that more who are interested in exporting can come into that process and start working their way through that. As I said earlier, it can take a number of years from thinking about exporting to actually exporting. And I think that was the second part of your question about...
Yeah, the second part was about the budget, but can I just go back to just tease that out? Is your target to grow exporting by the 20% of companies you've identified for next year? Because you're saying it takes longer, so I'm curious to know, do you have a target for next year?
So the way that we set it out in terms of our top-line measures that we report to government on is about value. And about value of company turnover, which goes to international sales. So that's the key target. But I have to say, beneath that, it is quite important, because whilst the value target is clearly critical to the performance of the economy overall, in any case, there are always a number of big companies that will contribute significantly to that target. So it's equally important that we do continue to ensure that we are increasing and broadening the base of exporting companies overall, even if some of them are coming in at fairly slow and low levels in terms of value, they are starting that exporting journey. So increasing both the volume and the value are part of what we want to achieve there. And in terms of resourcing, so I suppose we don't chunk our budget up exactly in that way, because we look at what we support to business overall. But if there's some figures that we can extract for you, we'll pass them on to you.
That would be very helpful to know. Can I turn, convener, to productivity? Because I think we'd all agree it's key to economic growth. There is the national performance target, which is that Scotland should be in the top quartile of OECD companies for productivity by 2017. There are weeks to go to the commencement of 2017. We're 19th, well off target in the third quartile. So I'm curious to know what contribution HIE made to increasing levels of productivity last year, and what you're going to do next year? Is it more of the same? Are we creating a step change? You know, and how does the budget relate to that?
So I guess the proxy for productivity is around GVA. We can certainly give you the number in terms of our GVA. The reality, though, is for productivity in the Highlands and Islands lag behind Scotland, who lag behind UK, so there is definitely a challenge for us in productivity. Some of this is pretty structural. It's about the size of the business base, and again, whatever is writ for Scotland is writ larger for the Highlands and Islands in terms of the size of businesses within that business base, tending much towards the micro business. So there is a challenge there. The makeup of sectors in the Highlands and Islands, whilst I have referenced some of those, such as LifeScan and BASF, clearly some of the structure within food and drink and tourism means that they tend to be in lower wage rates and therefore in productivity terms also make a lesser contribution overall. So what we have to do there is make sure that we are supporting developments which target sectors where both the skill level and the pay rate is higher. We look at investing in productivity in companies, so using services such as SMAS to increase efficiency. We've seen that with the investment that I spoke about of CS Wind in wind towers in Kintyre, where they have identified efficiency improvements, which is part of CS Wind's target overall when they took over that factory, as they recognised that previously that factory had not been running as efficiently as it could be, so we're moving that forward. But I wouldn't underestimate the challenge in significantly closing the productivity gap. I'd also just like to say that our view of productivity, and it's back to our discussion about skills, is also about the productivity of the individual. In the Highlands and Islands, we do have a challenge of underemployment for people as well, and that making sure that people are as productive as they could be and that their skills and capabilities are fully utilised is equally essential, both to productivity but also for the well-being and effectiveness of our communities and businesses.
Okay, thank you for that. Convener, can I turn to gender? A theme started by the Deputy Convener. Do you do a gender impact analysis of your budget? And if you do, can the committee have sight of that during the budget process? I think that would be very useful. And as part of that, how much do you allocate to encouraging women's enterprise directly, again, as a percentage of your budget? And I appreciate you might not count it that way, but any exercise that would help draw that out would be very much appreciated.
Okay, so we can certainly undertake an exercise to take those figures for you. But what we do is ensure that any programme that we develop, for example, Innovate Your Business and Innovation Programme, undertakes an equality assessment so that we look at that, and all of our account managers are trained as well in equality assessment so that we're making sure that those things are front of mind for those people that we put before business to talk to them and advise them so that we can support them in making the right decisions about how they can grow their businesses and make sure that they're taking full advantage of all the fantastic talent that's out there.
Convener, a point of information. I think when Charlotte Wright first gave a presentation, she indicated there wasn't an MSP on the committee covered by High. I think if she looks closely, my constituency stretches from Arica and Succoth to the rest and be thankful. So a tiny bit of my constituency is within High.
Oh, I'm
there you
sorry,
go.
That's a terrible error to make. Apologies for that.
That's all right.
It's very difficult for everyone to keep track of all these boundaries and how they change, I think, from time to time, but thank you for that.
Make sure you're on the list for our Highlands and Islands MSP briefings.
Excellent. We'll now move on to a question from Ash Denham.
I'm interested in the account management process. So you said that your ambition is to support businesses' growth aspirations and that you choose the businesses that you put into account management based on their growth potential. So I'm interested, how do you judge the success of the account management process? Do you set targets So you've talked quite a bit about number of employees. Would you set targets for that so that you would be able to judge that progress, say, over a year, 2 years, or?
Yeah, so we look at that in terms of tracking our measures, which are about job creation and about turnover, including international turnover. But we do also undertake periodic whole evaluations of account management. So we have done one reasonably recently, so I can make sure that you have a copy of that full evaluation, if that would be helpful.
So obviously we've touched, the number of exporters, the value of the exports or how many companies are exporting would be one of those judgments of success. So you said in answer to Jackie Bailey's question that 57% of those that you're account managing are exporting. Would you be able to tell us how many that was last year and the year before so we can see if that is an upward trajectory?
Yes, certainly we can do that.
Okay. And the same thing with, number of employees. Are you able to say if they've gone up as well?
Yes, so we track the projects which we support, which create jobs. So in terms of those investments, we can see what jobs have been added. We also track with the businesses that we work with what employment there is. The only challenge in that is that the account management portfolio is dynamic, so that people will come in and go out of that, so that we're not actually just, so you wouldn't be working with the same group. So there would be a challenge about how you're tracking that information that way.
Okay.
But if there's anything we can add to that specifically, we'll have a look and see if we can provide you a bit more detail there.
Okay. And is there any sort of, I don't know how to phrase this, is there any sort of push to the businesses that you can't manage in terms of taking up the Scottish Government's business pledge? Is that something that you try to encourage them to do?
Yeah, so again, account managers will promote the benefits of working to the Scottish business pledge with account managed businesses.
Would you be able to give me a percentage on that of how many of them have signed up?
Yes, it's 24, I think, for the Highlands and Islands overall, of which 17 are account managed.
Okay, thank you.
Right, well, thank you very much. Thank you to both of our guests today. We'll conclude this part of the session and we'll then have a brief break to allow you to leave and our next guest to take up their position. Thank you very much. Well, welcome to Dr. Lena Wilson and Ian Scott. I think, Lena, you are the Chief Executive Officer of Scottish Enterprise, and Ian, you're Chief Financial Officer. So welcome to the committee today. And we'll start with a question from Ash Denham. Oh, sorry, again, I think one of you has an opening statement. My apologies to Ash Denham. I'll let Dr. Wilson, I think it is, make the opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be very brief. Thanks for having us this morning, and good morning, everyone. It's nice to be in front of fresh faces on a new committee. I always look forward to this. We're in very challenging times, I don't need to tell you that, and I do welcome the opportunity not just really to present what Scottish Enterprise is up to, but even though I've been at economic development a very long time, we're certainly not the font of all knowledge, so I do look forward to discussing with you your ideas on what else you think we could be doing to support growth that we're not doing. We're in a very challenging global economic climate. We're seeing economic growth in the US, which is Scotland's largest market, continue to be robust, but we all know that there are uncertainties around that in the future. China continues to grow, albeit at less pace, but we would take that growth, wouldn't we? But there are moves in China to a more domestic agenda and building up the domestic companies in China, so that's an issue as well. We're still feeling the impacts of oil and gas, but all the data would tell us we seem to have reached the bottom of that, and that there seems now to be very good efficiency around the new normal of $50 a barrel. And then we've got uncertainty around our relationships with the EU. That means that trading conditions for Scottish businesses continue to be very tough. Although there's two sides of the coin to where sterling is at the moment, we're seeing the increased international competitiveness of our exports. But we're also seeing increased costs of imported goods and services. So just, our job day in daily is to be mindful of all of that and to be as fleet as foot in reacting to it as possible, and to help the companies particularly that we support be aware of that, have it front of their mind to react. So our role still remains, and that's the role that we've been given from government, is to find and focus the best opportunities on growth. I've been saying to all of our staff recently, regardless of where we are in this global turmoil, we are paid to find opportunity, and that's what we must do in any circumstances. We've worked very hard in recent years to drive much greater returns for investment that we make on behalf of the taxpayers. Since 2008, you know that our budgets have gone up and down, but approximately a 16% reduction in real terms. But in that same time frame, we have increased our international footprint around the world by a third. We have seen high-value jobs that we brought to Scotland up 32%. The companies we work most closely with have continued to grow. The turnover on the account-managed companies, their turnover has increased 20% since 2010, now up to $3.6 billion. The new investment that we've secured for growing Scottish companies through our co-investment funds has increased threefold. Export support has nearly doubled. In 11-12, we were supporting 1,300 companies to export. That's now 2,600 companies. And I just caught the tail end of one of the questions to Hi. So the percentage of Scottish enterprise account-managed companies that export is now 70%. It was 60% around 18 months ago, and we're hoping for 80% next year. Such is the importance of internationalisation on a company's competitiveness. We've also driven a whole range of new services and innovation support, much more small grants to get companies thinking about new markets, because too few of our companies are innovating new products and services. After the financial crisis, we've earmarked a lot of people resource for financial readiness, helping companies understand how to get finance and what would help them grow. We've developed a high growth markets unit, so tailored support for markets like China and India. We've launched a workplace innovation approach to help stimulate excellent employment practices. That doesn't have to always cost very much, but innovation isn't just products and services. It can be how you deal with your people. And in the next 3 years, just finally, we want to go further still, responding to the Enterprise and Skills Review. We want to use technology more to transform our model. So how can I make sure that all of these assets Scottish Enterprise has in terms of our knowledge, expertise, can go as far as possible to as many businesses as possible, not just the ones that Scottish Enterprise supports? How can we give even more support to local and regional economies? Local authorities tell us they value our input. We work with every single community planning partnership in Scotland. As a national agency, it's sometimes been difficult for us to meet all their demands for input and support, so how can we do that digitally? We want to invest in a new system to join up all of our efforts in Scotland internationally. There's lots of activity internationally in Scotland, but you know, the whole isn't always greater than the sum of the parts, so we are working with Visit Scotland to join that up. And then something I think you will want to discuss is new activities targeted at inclusive growth, a new measure, a new approach last year for the enterprise agencies. So, for example, a new leadership programme specifically targeted at women in account-managed companies, delivery of productivity plans for high employment sectors but low-paid sectors like tourism, food and drink and construction. Also, food and drink can be very important for rural areas. So we are facing into new challenges, but we faced into lots of new challenges before. I will ensure that we have a relentless focus on the actions that will deliver impact for Scotland. There's lots of things that people would like Scottish Enterprise to do. There's lots of things we could do. Our job is to do the things which give the greatest return to the economy. That's the role that government has asked us to fulfil, and it's my role as accountable officer. So, convener, thank you very much for the opportunity to make some brief remarks. I hope they've set the scene, and I look forward to questions and discussion.
Thank you very much. And now, Ash Denham.
Good morning. Thank you for answering some of my question in your opening statement. So I'm quite interested in the account management of Scottish Enterprise just as much as I was for High as well. So you've said that turnover is up 20% roughly in the last sort of 6 years. You've said that the number of companies that are exporting is also up and that 70% of your account managed businesses are exporters. Do you have any figures on the number of employees? Have they also increased over the last sort of 5 years?
Yeah, I think they've created around 7,000 employees. I can't remember if that's in the last 3 years or the timescale, Ash, but I'll certainly get that to you. So employment growth is a big factor. I mean, I always say to companies, our job is to help them make more money and or save more money, preferably both. So, increasing top line growth, improving efficiency, and that generally helps them create better employment. But the quality of employment is really important as well. So now we'd be really working with all of our account managed companies. Over 1,000 of our companies meet the requirements of the business pledge, although only 100 and something have signed up to it. So sometimes companies don't want to sign up to something official, but they're doing it anyway. So we want to have discussions around gender equality, because actually that helps growth. It's not either or, it all helps growth.
Yesterday, Gordon Lyndhurst and I went to visit a tech incubator in Edinburgh. And I suppose if we're thinking about the fact that the UK and Scotland are maybe not improving in terms of productivity as much as we would like them to, and obviously that's a key driver for levels of growth and improving the economy, these sort of new tech companies could be quite significant in that. And what he was saying was that these very new tech companies are looking to be disruptive. So that was the way he described it. They're literally doing something that just hasn't been done before. They're not improving things or making things more efficient. It's just a completely new thing. And what he was saying is that, and he did mention SE actually, and he was saying the, if we're talking about in terms of, account management, that the old rules for starting and managing and growing businesses don't apply for these type of new companies. And I suppose I'm interested in, have you got any, are you focusing on those type of new companies or are you sticking to the more traditional companies? Are we looking for the next Skyscanner? What are we doing, in that space?
I really believe that Scotland has the capability to have many more unicorns, so companies that value at £1 billion over 5 years, as we've seen with Skyscanner and with FanDuel. We were a major investor into FanDuel. We weren't an early investor into Skyscanner, but we helped them enormously along the way, including, helping broker introduction to their new partner in China. Our most prominent account management support and investment support is actually in the tech sector at the moment. And I would argue that that's what economic development is about. It is about taking risk. It's about working with companies pre-revenue before they've even formed. And if you think that in the School of Informatics at Edinburgh University, we have the 12th highest ranking School of Informatics out of 800 in the world, it's just a jewel in our crown not to exploit. So we put more resources, for example, Ash, into California, because I truly believe that we could get born global companies coming to Scotland. I met in London just 2 weeks ago with a company from Boston that we are trying to persuade to actually start up in Scotland in the tech space, because we've got better software engineers, they're very productive, they don't move around as much, and they're more cost effective. So we're doing a lot in this space. Most of our venture capital is into tech companies. So the supply of graduates is really important to that. The risk capital is really important to that, and this mindset about understanding these disruptors. But Scotland has a terrific asset here. I would argue that data and the data and technology could be our next industrial revolution in Scotland. So I'm, you know, very, very willing to lead from the front on that.
And I suppose the challenges, and this was mentioned yesterday as well, about skill shortages and, you know, the ability to recruit from other EU countries, but also from other places in the world. Do you think that will be a concern for some of these companies, that, you know, these tech companies that you've mentioned, about being able to get the right people as a result maybe of Brexit?
Well, Scottish Enterprise has a resource called Talent Scotland, and our, you know, that very role is working with companies to help them find ways to identify talent from around the world. But yes, I would be particularly worried about the attraction of talent or the challenges to that or the barriers being put there, because you know, we have a really excellent record in talent attraction to our universities. We've got an excellent record of our university graduates from overseas staying in Scotland, and we've got a great offer in terms of quality of life. A company like Avaloq, who are one of the leading companies in the world for software development for the financial services company, came to Edinburgh on the back of no financial assistance at all, in competition with the Philippines and in competition with Brazil, purely on the back of our talent.
Okay, thank you.
Might I just ask as a follow-up on that, one of the things that was mentioned during that visit was a risk-averse culture in Scotland and an unwillingness of people to risk starting a business and failing. And failure is part of the learning process, from what we were told. What are you doing to address this? Well, first of all, would you agree there's a risk-averse culture in Scotland? And second, what are you doing to address that issue?
I think that the risk aversion is changing. So I think as we see more business stories being given to start-up, as we see more role models who have started businesses. And so if you live in California, you're used to words like pivot. So that's when a, you know, a business starts, get its investment to do one thing, doesn't give up, realizes that market isn't right, and does another. So as we get more used to that and not see that as a failure. So, you know, we're in the risk business. Economic development is not a dead cert. We should only be doing stuff that wouldn't happen without us. We had, you know, £19 million of write-offs. Well, you know, that's criticised, but that is risk. At the same token, we had, what, 36 million or 30-something million of gains. So, you know, inherently what we do is risky. We, as a country, have tried to really get behind, I mean, I'm just being very open and transparent, wave technology, because the market wasn't ready to do it. That doesn't always work. So, you know, I would argue that a lot of the pre-revenue investment we make is inherently risky. Not everything we do will work. But the more we talk about that, the more we understand it, and we're a country that fails fast. I mean, we don't want to be cavalier with taxpayers' money. That's absolutely, you know, I wouldn't be sitting here today if I were found to be that. But it is an issue. But I think younger people, and certainly I can only speak for the young people that we bring into Scottish Enterprise, we have an apprentice programme now. I want to get at least 5% of our workforce under the age of 25. They are much more technologically aware. They are very fleet of foot. They teach us a lot. And they just understand this a bit better. So it's really important.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald had a brief follow-up.
A very, very quick question on the back of the question that Ash had. You've mentioned a number of times about the importance of tech companies, but one of the written submissions to the Enterprise Review said, I think that Scottish enterprise has never really embraced micro firms and their needs. So many schemes are all about leading cutting-edge technology, and in my mind, that is muddled thinking. If you concentrate on making companies incrementally better at what they do, then you would see a real improvement in our competitiveness and export success. So do you see that as your role, to actually support companies that are doing well but needs that support to actually increase their growth, increase employment opportunities, and increase their exports?
I think that's it's a debate I often get involved in. The role of Scottish enterprise that's been given to us by government is growth, transformative growth. The role of supporting micro enterprises in the last review was given to Business Gateway. So it is the role of local authorities through Business Gateway to support micro enterprises. And then it's our role to work really closely with Business Gateway to make sure that if there's growth potential in any of those micro enterprises, that we've got this pipeline of support where they come to us, and that's increasing all the time. Now, we support quite a lot of pre-revenue companies if we think there's market potential, product potential, and we make a lot of investment in that. We've got a dedicated high-growth support team that looks pre-revenue, that looks at companies that haven't even formed yet. So, a lot of that's in the tech space because that's where the world's going, but actually, you know, we support a massive amount of, you know, food and drink companies, tourism companies, construction companies, textiles companies, because we've got such a great offering there too. So it's not either or, but it is important to say that the role of supporting micro business is not the role of Scottish Enterprise, it's the role of Business Gateway.
Thank you. And Dean Lockhart, you had a follow-up on that as well.
Yes, thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
One of the findings of the Phase 1 Enterprise Review was that there's a cluttered landscape in terms of enterprise support and confusion over sources of finance. The government recently announced a Scottish growth scheme of £500 million, which will take the form of guarantees and loans. There seems to be a bit of confusion in the community as to how that's going to operate. Have there been any guidelines issued or any criteria issued about how companies can take advantage of this? And do you have a breakdown of the £500 million? Do you have a breakdown of how much will be in the form of loans or other forms of financial help, and what percentage will be guarantees?
I think the detail of that has been worked out. It's Scottish Government scheme, and we are working with them on that. So I don't have all of that detail to hand, but we are making sure that all of our staff know about it, all of our account managers know about it. We do a lot of continuous professional development with our account managers so they can start to talk to companies. And actually what we have is a whole raft of financial readiness advisors who, as soon as we have the detail, can get out there. But through the Scottish Business Development Bank, we've been working with the Scottish Government in expanding the reach. We have co-investment funds, we have loan funds, and this will be a welcome addition to that, but we don't yet have all the detail.
Okay. Can I ask a related question? Of the companies that you manage or assist, over, say, a 3 to 5 year period, what percentage of those companies will fail, talking about market failure? I'm just looking for a sort of ballpark figure here in terms of the companies that you have assisted, either financially or otherwise.
Well, we would assist about 12,000 companies a year in total. We would account manage in the region of 2,600. Every year, a few hundred would come in to that portfolio and a few hundred would go out. They wouldn't go out because they'd failed, but they might go out because actually they've reached a plateau on their growth, or quite simply they don't want to work with us anymore, or they don't want to go into other markets. So there's an in and out, but it doesn't mean that they've all failed. As I said to you, we've had some significant understandable write-offs for companies that have gone down, but actually we've also managed to rescue quite a lot of companies. So we would have all of that detail, and I can absolutely get it to you. But the companies that Scottish Enterprise account manage on every factor do better than those that we don't, that are not account managed, including employing women, employing graduates, employing young people. They're more efficient, they're more effective. So I want to see us being able to account manage as many companies as would be eligible for it. We need to grow the pipeline in Scotland of companies that are willing and ready to grow so that then we can account manage them.
You mentioned earlier that you had supported a couple of the major success stories. What percentage of investment is equity linked, where you have an upside as opposed to a direct grant or a direct loan, so that if a company like Skyscanner goes through the scales, that you have some kind of equity linked upside at the end of the day?
Well, all of our co-investment funds are equity through the Scottish Investment Bank. We would have a few hundred million pounds worth of funds under, assets under management there, Ian?
I think it's about 450 million, something we're at the moment. It's about 80 million a year we put in through investments by way of shares.
So that's all equity.
It's crystallised. Can you talk us how, just in terms of budget, how does that, is there a line item where that is, or
yes,
is it accounted as a profit or income?
It's accounted as a profit, which up to a certain threshold we are allowed to retain and therefore reinvest back into similar companies going forward. We've never reached over that threshold yet. Should we sell one of the ones that Lena talked about earlier, we may well do that. But at the moment, we reinvest it in the following year, or the year, sorry, that we get the income and the surplus coming back in.
But last year, for example, we realised
33 million.
Was realised from those investments to the public purse to be reinvested.
A couple of final specific questions, if I may. Phase one also of the review announced a new board of trade to be established to oversee the enterprise agencies and other agencies. Since then, we've had an announcement by the government that a strategic board will replace the individual boards of the enterprise agencies and other agencies. Can we get, obviously there's a bit more analysis to be done here, but can we get your initial view on the fact that the board of Scottish Enterprise will be replaced by an overarching strategic board?
Well, my view on that is that we'll work really closely with government to make this work. It's my job to make all of that work. I welcome any efforts to coordinate what we all do across Scotland better. I welcome every effort to declutter the landscape. We just have to make sure that we design that well and we get the right people on board and that we meet all of the needs of the Scottish economy. So it's my job to not so much have a view, but to make it work.
And final question, if I may. You mentioned Global Scots, the Global Scot Network in your paper. Can you tell us how effective you think the Global Scot Network is and if there are any proposed changes coming up to the structure of the Global Scots Network?
I think the Global Scot Network is a real jewel in the crown in Scotland. I've been involved in it since its very inception. And, these people are unpaid. Are willing to. I always say that our job is to ruthlessly exploit them for the value of Scotland. They're all over the world. We're using our Global Scots to try and attract new foreign direct investment because that this whole world of FDI is going to get very challenging. I met the software company I talked about earlier. I can't go into any further detail, but that introduction was made by a Global Scot. Increasingly, we're seeing some of our inward investment leads given to us by Global Scots. Our last evaluation said that Global Scots helped Scottish companies generate somewhere in the region of £30 million of additional business. So we try and evaluate it as much as possible, but they're highly positioned in a lot of our key sectors and companies around the world, and we use them as much as we can. I think we should be thanking them all very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian Martin had a question or questions.
I genuinely do just have a supplementary question.
but don't hesitate to follow up with
six.
A supplementary.
I want to come back to something that you said earlier about identifying young people to start up in business. I convene a cross-party group called Women in Enterprise, and one of the things that we found out very early is that female graduates are one of the demographics that are not setting up in business related to what they're studying. And as a former college lecturer myself, what I found with my students is that they were going into the world graduating without any idea of how to actually set up in business. And I'm wondering if that's something that you're tackling and getting in early into colleges and universities at the point where people are graduating to assist them in actually looking at enterprise as an actual possible route.
I think that's a very good question. I served on the board of the Prince's Youth Business Trust for 10 years, so I have a huge passion in young people and starting up business. And you know, the issue of women going into business generally, we will tackle that if we get girls thinking about going into business. Now, this isn't a specific remit of Scottish Enterprise, but we do as much as we can on that. A lot of our staff speak in schools. You know, I've done lean-in events for young girls. I'm meeting tomorrow morning three young women who want to meet me and grill me. They're three of our graduates this year. I'm considering a reverse mentoring programme with a young woman between the ages of 17 and 21. And if we can do that as role models, you know, that's really, really important. The Scottish Enterprise doesn't have a specific programme for young girls. But Skills Development Scotland work in this space.
But effectively, we've identified already an area in which Scottish Enterprise could do more in actually targeting. And you talk about, you know, risk averse. The most risk averse people in our society are probably with people who are at the point when the cusp of actually leaving education and going out into the world where they don't have mortgages, they don't have families, they don't have responsibilities. And surely that there could be a help housing opportunity there of actually encouraging.
Quite a bit of that in Scotland with all of our incubators, and you know, in terms of, we're seeing a lot of young women, increasing numbers of young women go into them all over Scotland. They're not run by Scottish Enterprise, but we work very closely with them. We've just agreed a 10-point action plan with Women Enterprise Scotland on a whole range of things we could do. One of the things that we could do is maybe better communication and marketing and role models. I would be very willing that if there's anything specifically, I said that we are considering a special programme for leadership programme for women in account managed companies. So if there's anything we could do that would involve young girls. The other thing that we do is we have Mentoring Scotland. Actually, only a very small percentage of the mentors are women, less than 15%, yet 30-odd participants, mentees, if you like, are women. So we need to match that. So Scottish Enterprise, what we can do, Gillian, is bring a lot of influence. Even if we're not delivering it, we can bring a lot of influence. We've got a lot of reach. We can use our Global Scots. So I'd be very willing to see if there's anything else that we can do. We are working very closely with Women Enterprise Scotland on this 10-point action plan. And I participated in the Investing Women Conference. So this was how young women can get startup capital. That was the first of its kind. And we're working with them on how they could, you know, access international finance for that as well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. Ownership and how different ownership models for businesses, is that a factor in how you look at things? Because there's a bit of a push for, should there be more social enterprises, should there be more cooperatives, or do you kind of tend to favour the traditional owner, one owner or a group of owners or share owners or whatever?
I'm very, very interested in innovation around business models, and I think part of that is ownership. So I spoke last year at the big employee ownership conference that we had in Scotland. Cooperative Development Scotland is part of Scottish Enterprise. We're working with Social Enterprise Scotland now on a particular scaling programme, how we could scale up social enterprises. One of our renewable energy investment funds was to a housing association on community energy to reinvest into social housing. We work with the Homeless World Cup on their global ambitions. So actually, I think a rich economy has many, many ownership models. Also, a big way to counteract some of the problems that family businesses have with succession, when there aren't family generation, you know, for the next generation, is employee ownership. So we've been working with a couple of great companies, engineering companies, who are moving to employee ownership. I can think of one company in East Kilbride, and getting as many role models as possible there. So, you know, employee ownership, social enterprises with global aspirations. But again, whilst we don't have a specific community development role that HI has, I think a rich economy is a very diverse economy, so we can bring our expertise to any of that, particularly, say, in rural areas, then we do that.
Okay, well, seeing you mention HIE, because I was asking them also about their social development, strengthening communities kind of role, is that something, well, either that you think you should have or they don't need to have, or is it just too different?
Well, I wouldn't presume ever to say what HI shouldn't or shouldn't have. I think they're a fantastic organisation. Scottish Enterprise's role is economic development, particularly growth and transformative growth in sectors, in the business infrastructure, and in companies. And then it's our job to influence as much else as possible. So I'm always very willing, John, to push the envelope for Scottish enterprise as much as possible. We do not have a specific community development remit. Regional economic development was given to the local authorities. And as I said, small business and micro business development was given to Business Gateway. But we participate in every single community planning partnership in our area. We're working with the City Deals. We've done a tremendous amount of work with North Ayrshire, resulting in Team North Ayrshire, which I think is a great blueprint for how we can work with the wider community. So, you know, I think it's very important for the economy and we'll do everything we can, but it isn't, you know, community development is not a specific remit of Scottish enterprise.
Okay. If we go back to the ownership question, I mean, you were talking earlier on to previous questions about, you know, kind of getting your money back out when you sell a stake. So does that suggest there's a kind of bias on Scottish enterprise for businesses to sell out rather than continue to grow with a Scottish headquarters? Because I see Skyscanner as a failure because we have lost a Scottish headquarters. I saw Scottish Power as a failure because we lost a Scottish headquarters. Are you kind of, you're relaxed about that?
Oh, I'm really relaxed about anything. But what I would say is that we're in a global economy. We want to grow global Scottish businesses. Now, we've got Scottish businesses who go out and acquire other businesses all over the world. We're very happy about that. We're relaxed about that. The quid pro quo is that not every business that grows in Scotland will end up owned in Scotland. However, what Skyscanner will have is that's allowing us access to a huge Chinese company for the first time. I'll be seeking other investment from that. They are committed to Scotland as their European headquarters. They are committed to grow in Scotland. And actually, the trend is, John, that most companies that are acquired, they're acquired, they have deeper pockets, and they still grow in Scotland. That has been the trend. So whilst I would love all of our companies to be Scottish-owned and global, the reality of the world just isn't like that. And so we want to do everything we can to, you know, encourage that. But also, actually, to the first part of your question, a relatively modest part of what Scottish Enterprise does is in venture capital and risk capital in terms of our total budget. Most of our budget is supporting Scottish companies to grow. So it's just, we're looking for a return on the risk capital because I don't want to lose public money. I want to get a return so that I can reinvest it.
Okay. And the other section I wanted to look at was, I mean, we are looking at this in relation to the budget, so we are interested. We don't know what the budget is yet. But, I mean, how sensitive is the work you do to a change in the budget? So if the budget, your budget went up 5%, could you do a lot more, or would it just be tweaking things? If your budget went down 5%, would that make a big impact, or would it just mean tweaking things a little bit?
Well, again, I keep going back to what my job is. My job is to do always the best with whatever budget we're given and not to complain about it, but just to get on with it. But, you know, we're probably reaching the levels that we can get to in terms of, you know, efficiencies. We've tried to be as efficient as possible. We've tried to be as effective as possible. So, you know, we could always, invest more in helping companies internationalise. So, for example, I've said we've increased our offices footprint internationally by a third. That's very expensive. That was several million pounds. So if we wanted to significantly increase our international footprint, that would require additional budget. That would be an example. We would never just take a salami slicing approach. So a 5% budget cut means we just cut everything 5%. We'd go back again and look at the things that are most likely to yield the biggest return for the Scottish economy, try and protect those, be as efficient as we can. You know, but it's not as easy as that. But, you know, I think I started by saying that even though our budget has increased by 16% in real terms by 2008, we've done what we ask every business in Scotland to do. We've actually achieved more. There has to be limits to that, though.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Gil Patterson.
I wonder, with regards to your contacts with Scottish business, what the general attitude to Brexit is at the present time.
I can tell you that because we monitor it. We have every quarter we go out and speak to 500 companies to see how they're doing. I think the general attitude is that businesses, and I can get those specific numbers to you, the general attitude is that businesses are very uncertain and that they just still don't know how this will affect them. They tend to think it will more negatively affect them. That's our economic trends review. Actually, it might be useful for the committee to get that every month. I'd be very happy to give you that. It's just a snapshot of... I'm not suggesting, Gil, you can read it from here, but I think...
if I could read it.
The companies we work with tend to be more positive by virtue of the fact that they're growing companies, and that's why we're working with them. So I have to say that up front. There's a lot of uncertainty. More of them think that Brexit will affect them negatively than positively. But it's really important to understand that it doesn't affect all companies in the same way. It affects financial services companies greatly because of issues like passporting and movement of people. It doesn't affect maybe some of our larger multinational companies so greatly because they're in lots of markets all over the world. It affects companies like textiles companies and hospitality because of the movement of people. So it depends on the sector, but there's a lot of uncertainty. Uncertainty is the enemy of confidence, and a lack of confidence is the enemy to investment. And that's why we're seeing this hesitancy and slowing down, even for companies that might have some cash in the bank.
I can understand that because I don't know if anybody really knows what Brexit actually means in the long term. But the one thing that we do know is, and you touched on it, the strength of the pound. And I'm wondering, with the feedback that you've got, how is that impacting right here now? Is it is it negative or is it positive? You know, I can tell you about my business, but I'm not here to do that. But I'm wondering what you're getting back from Scottish business.
So we are out actively encouraging companies where they are already exporting to really up the ante on exporting and take advantage of where we are with the pound, because exporting is, you know, going to be more beneficial in terms of returns. Where companies book their currency and book their profits in other currency, actually that's quite advantageous to some of them, but those are just short-term gains. The import substitution issue is a real problem because that becomes much more expensive. So companies buying ingredients or raw materials or parts of the supply chain. But the optimist in me would say that actually it's our job then to think of what, you know, what we can do for Scottish companies to get into that supply chain. So you know, we have to be a bit more forensic about this. There is opportunity. And there's a cost, and we need to focus on the opportunity, but be very realistic about the cost. In the oil and gas slowdown, for the very first time, we had to work with companies in the oil and gas supply chain just on their financial resilience. We've never seen that before. So we're used to doing this, and if companies are really struggling as a result of this, there's lots we can do in advice to help them, you know, eke out their cash, to help them ride some of this out, to help them be more efficient, and we'll do that as well as the opportunity side of it.
Okay, thanks for that. Okay.
Thank you. Liam Kerr.
Thank you. So I'm interested, like John Mason, in the forthcoming budget. I was interested in your opening remarks. You said that oil and gas, we've reached the bottom of that, but you'll be aware that the EY Scottish Item Club report came out yesterday talking about the future for Aberdeen in particular, saying that the oil and gas hub continues to be affected by falling oil prices, and total employment in the city is expected to fall by 1.6% in 2016 and 4,000 through to 2019. Can I ask then, what is Scottish Enterprise's response to that? You've just said you've done quite a lot of work on financial resilience up to this point, but this is obviously new information. And does this news change your spending and budgeting allocation and your projections going forward?
For oil and gas specifically?
Sure, or yes. For the North East and for Aberdeen.
Yeah, so I mean, I also have the privilege of chairing Scotland's Oil and Gas Jobs Task Force. So I go to Aberdeen tomorrow for 2 days. I've spent probably more time in Aberdeen in the last year than I certainly have in the city I live in. So it's been really important. We have just redirected a massive amount of people and budgetary resource We've worked with 700 companies in the oil and gas supply chain. We've had a whole series of events, in Scotland. We've got a pipeline of about 30 innovation projects in Aberdeen at the moment. We've worked with Ian Wood and his team on the new One Northeast board, and we're on that board. We've worked on the city deal. We are working on diversifying food and drink, tourism, life sciences. I think there are huge opportunities for Aberdeen to be the world's global hub for all technology around the subsea. Even when the oil is gone in 40, 50 years' time, we should be the global hub for subsea. There are massive opportunities in decommissioning. I've met with 30 companies specifically. I go and meet Nexen tomorrow. As I say, I chair the task force. So we're doing absolutely everything that we can because... oil and gas and food and drink have been two massively important sectors for Scotland. And, I've been an advocate of don't waste a crisis. So use this terrible time to be more efficient, more effective, help the industry become more cohesive, more collaborative, more standardisation of products. I've had three trade union representatives on the task force working on workforce relations. So we do have a fact sheet on everything that the task force has achieved, and I'm happy to get that to the committee as well. So, the reality of this is it's been very challenging, but actually I've never seen such collaboration from an industry for a very long time, and I think this is focusing the minds on the other opportunities that I've mentioned in the other sectors for the North East as well.
Thank you. That's really encouraging. It's good to hear. Does that make you think, though, in this budget round, because obviously you've projected on the current situation and how it looks like it's going to develop, but obviously we've had this news now that there may be more to come. Does that mean that you'll be needing more budget from the government to carry out all of these good measures going forward?
I don't know. I mean, I resisted. I've asked everybody, and I want to thank all political parties because we've largely resisted it. I begged everyone not to make the task force a political football because we're just trying to do everything we can for the sector. My job is also to get other people to spend the money if possible and for it not to be Scottish Enterprise, so encouraging the industry to step up, working with Skills Development Scotland to redirect their budget, and they've been absolutely terrific, working hand in hand with Highlands and Enterprise. So often it's not about just throwing extra budget at something, it is about a level of collaboration and being more efficient. Oil and Gas UK, working with them and seeing what we can do through their members, the Oil and Gas Authority, who are also on the task force. So I don't jump to increase budget as the first answer. But, it's my job also that if we find opportunities that can only be matched by budget, then it's my job to talk to government about how we might meet that. But so far, I can't say that we're not able to do anything because of a lack of budget. So far.
Just one final quick question, just to clarify something for me. So we've been looking at the Enterprise and Skills Review. There'll be the creation of the new South of Scotland agency. How does that impact on Scottish Enterprise in terms of budget? I mean, how will that be funded for, and is there any risk that it comes out of your pot?
I can't answer that because we don't have the answers to that yet, and I suppose that's all to be worked through, and we'll work very closely with it in the next stage of the review. Scottish Enterprise does a great deal in the south of Scotland. We account manage a significant number of companies in the south of Scotland. We work with the South of Scotland Alliance. Actually, Ian is our most senior representative. We have someone in our top team covering important areas, and Ian covers the south of Scotland, so he may wish to add to that. But we're not at the stage where we know anything about budgets yet. I mean, Scottish Enterprise spends £6 million a year in the High Region. Scottish Enterprise currently is the national agency, so Scottish Investment Bank, the Manufacturing Advisory Service, the Reef Fund, Scottish Development International. These are all pan-Scotland services, and I would imagine that that would continue. So it's really important that you understand that Scottish Enterprise also covers the whole of Scotland for much of what we do, and there's strength in that national approach, but we still have to work that detail out. Do you want to add anything, Ian?
If I can maybe add a couple of things, Lena, just on your last point there, It's actually about just over 50% of Scottish enterprises' operational budgets are available pan-Scotland at the moment, so they're available in the Highlands and Islands region, and I can't imagine anybody would not want those available in the south of Scotland region going forward. As Lena says, SDI, the Scottish Investment Banks, ESMAS and a number of others cover that. Yeah, I've had initial discussions myself with both councils now. I was actually at a South of Scotland Alliance meeting yesterday, and it is just too early to say as to what that vehicle may evolve into, but certainly there's been good discussions about making sure that it was very focused for the key issues that are unique to the south of Scotland, that Scottish Enterprise maybe hasn't focused as much on in the past. It should absolutely be focusing on that, but not losing the integration that it can have with the kind of wider kind of sector team experience and some of the other operations that Scottish Enterprise continues with. So I'm sure we'll work together with the government to come up with a good answer that will be a model perhaps even for other areas in the country thereafter.
Thank you.
Gillian Martin.
Supplementary to Mr. Kerr's question about oil and gas, I mean, this afternoon you'll be aware that we're having a debate on renewable energy and this emerging energy technology in Scotland. We've got a real massive opportunity to capitalise on that with the skills base that we have in the northeast. Looking at diversification into new markets for people in the northeast from the oil and gas industry, what's been done to maximise the opportunity that there maybe is for construction, manufacture and working in the renewable sector, particularly I think in tidal, given that we really have a head start on that?
So we've been doing quite a lot in tidal. So the Maygen project, which is the first kind of commercially operating tidal project. The UK environment for energy policy has changed, brought some uncertainty into the future of that. Offshore wind, in terms of offshore wind platforms, if you look at Statoil and what they're planning for the northeast in terms of these floating offshore wind platforms, there's a lot going on in renewables. And actually, I think one of the positive factors of the last year with the oil and gas companies is that many of them are now looking to utilising their skills in renewables. And we knew that the application of oil and gas experience and technology could reduce the cost in renewables by about 25%. And we had to bring those costs down to make it a reality. But now I see more of the oil and gas companies themselves going into that. We work very closely with Scottish Renewables because a lot of the skills are transferable as well. So I think tidal, offshore wind are two really important. Carbon capture and storage, and then you go in off renewables into the kind of decommissioning opportunities as well. So we're working on all of those. And actually renewables isn't just for the northeast of Scotland. Renewables down in Hunterston with the Fife Energy Park with the turbine, you know, so it's something. Scotland, we have 25% of Europe's wind on our coastlines.
So you look at a country like Denmark, which is really a world leader in wind technology, and obviously quite a lot of Danish companies are coming over to Scotland to use our natural resources. What do you think could be done in Scotland to ensure that we become a world leader in, so for example, tidal technology in the way that Denmark has, manufacturing the hardware in Denmark and then exporting that to other countries? What opportunities do you see there for Scottish companies?
We currently are a world leader in the technology and the knowledge around weaving tidal in AMEC in Orkney, the European Marine Energy Centre. We have a world-class facility there. We've probably got some of the world's world-class test and demonstration facilities. We've got the best university knowledge, some of the stuff that Strathclyde, for example, and Robert Gordon and Aberdeen are doing around renewables, Heriot Watt, Edinburgh. So actually, we are world-class. Our job is to make sure that as much of that as possible is commercialised in Scotland. But a lot of this investment is very pre-commercial, so it's risky and it won't all work. And we saw that with some of the wave investment that we made. But as a country, we do have to go for this. So I see this as still very, very important for Scotland as part of our overall blended energy portfolio, actually, for our energy mix as well as our economic advantage.
We are a world leader in the technology and the innovation, but in the manufacturing side, there's not to my mind, enough manufacturing of the hardware being done in Scotland, which of course is a traditional engineering and construction world leader, shipbuilding, oil and gas, and now we could potentially be in renewables. What's been done there to attract the contracts? So, for example, we've got contracts, Scottish companies, but they've been manufactured in Belfast. What's been done to get that construction here?
Well, we need to make sure that we're building the supply chain here, we're building the opportunities here. So we'd be working with, for example, Statoil on an open innovation programme to see what kind of technology they would need and to see if Scotland can, you know, respond to that through the supply chain. Our board just made a very significant decision to make a significant ongoing investment in Fife Energy Park that would put better loading into that site and do a lot of stuff in the quay side because a lot of it is infrastructural. So those would be examples of the kind of things that we're doing, infrastructural, supply chain development, and then matching that with our inward investment opportunities. So CS Wind would be a very good example of bringing a Chinese investment to Scotland in that field.
To encourage that, what would be your key asks of both the governments in order to facilitate that?
Well, I think we've done very well in Scotland by pinning our colours to the mast here and actually saying that as a country. We've had, policies and targets around renewable energy, and then we've matched our economic development to that. When Amber Rudd was the Secretary of State for DEC, I went down and, you know, met with her and petitioned on behalf of Scotland because I think that the way the UK policy is going is quite challenging for us in that regard. So I would ask that we do everything we can to influence the right kind of policies that allow this to be financially viable and allow this early stage development to be financially viable.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I return to exports? And I understand absolutely that SE have a role in providing funding and having overview of SDI and therefore are in the lead on exporting. Now, obviously, Scotland's economic strategy had a target of increasing exports by 50% by 2017. And as I remarked earlier, that is but a few weeks away. How is your budget aligned to deliver on that?
I think I maybe picked up you asking Charlotte some of that, and we would be the same. I mean, I was making a note, Jackie, to try and disaggregate that for you while I was sitting there, but I didn't have the resource to do it. We don't manage our budget in that way that we would have a pot for exporting and a pot for, because we have a very blended approach to our account managed companies where we're just trying to do everything possible to make them grow. I mean, obviously, we have put a lot more money into SDI because we rely on too few exporters. You know, you'd be amazed to know that under 100 companies probably account for 90% of Scotland's exports. So the trick really is to get many thousands of companies exporting. That's why we've gone to another 1,000 companies, over 2,000 companies reached last year. So I could get you the figure for that. We're throwing everything at it that we possibly can. But it's really important that we don't just see this as, you know, an exporting pot. That's just for encouraging the new companies to export. But it's much more complex than that and sophisticated than that in terms of how you get a company to be ready to export, because you have to have the right product for the right market, the right leadership team, the right financial resources. And the worst thing we could ever do is encourage a company to go into an export market where, and we've discussed this before, where it just was not ready to do that because it will fail. So I think Charlotte said also earlier, it takes some time to do that. On the target, I said this at the time, I'm always a fan of a big, hairy target that is challenging and you might not reach than an easy target that you surpass. So I think we should, as a country, set stretching targets, hold people to account and do everything we can to achieve them. And, you know, we have to understand the kind of circumstances, because Scottish Enterprise is looking at only two targets that we might not make this year. One is foreign direct investment and the other is exporting. And that is wholly down to the kind of global environment that we're in the world and the levels of uncertainty that I spoke about earlier. you know, if you people want to beat me up for that, that's fine, but that's where we are. It doesn't stop us going for it, but it's going to be challenging.
Whilst I accept some of that, the target was from 2010 to 2017. So, you know, the challenging global conditions didn't really exist to that same degree before now. So, you know, I'm curious as to, it seems to be an admission we're not going to meet the target. But I think as policymakers, we need to understand why, in order that we can set equally challenging and ambitious targets in the future, but ones that maybe people might be able to achieve. So I am interested in what budget is applied to this. Your own business plan for 2015-18 gives SDI, I think, 42 million yes. this year, 43 million yes. next year.
Yes.
Now, the First Minister has made announcements around about priorities that she would like to see in terms of doubling the European exporting staff from 20 to 40. Are you anticipating new funding from the Scottish Government to cover this?
Yes.
In its entirety, or are you expected to provide any in-kind support?
I am expecting 100% additional funding for those new markets and new resources. I would point out, though, that 2010 was just a year after the financial crisis, too. It was very challenging. And, you know, I think, actually, we've come very far in exporting. I'll never be satisfied with how we're doing in it. But we will never get to exporting unless we all work on the levels of ambition in business, in young people, in the country. That underpins absolutely everything.
Can I pick you up on foreign direct investment? You said that you are likely not to meet your target for that. Can you refresh my memory what the target was and what the reason is that you've not been able to achieve it? Just
well,
so we understand.
For the last 7 years, Scotland has topped the UK for foreign direct investment. We have more than punched above our weight. When you consistently punch above your weight, there's going to be 1 year where that's not going to happen. So Ian is going to refresh my memory with what our specific target for that is. So we said that by 2018, we'll have attracted between 22,000 and 28,000 planned jobs through our investment. And then I can't remember what the capital. For 16-17, that we would attract between 7,000 and 9,000 jobs. I mean, we may meet it, but it will be at the bottom of the range. Yeah. And the conditions, it's the global environment. Foreign direct investment throughout the whole world is going to change this year, is going to fall. We're maybe seeing more kind of protectionist policies from the US. We're seeing more domestic agenda from China. There's the uncertainty around Europe as a, you know, the UK is a destination for companies looking for Europe. So it's just much more challenging. But Scotland has done remarkably well in foreign direct investment in the last 7 or so years. Top region outside London, highest amount of R&D per capita for foreign direct investment. So we've done very, very well.
Can I turn finally to productivity? Obviously, there's a national performance target here, the top quartile of OECD countries for productivity was the ambition by 2017. It looks like we're going to remain at 19th, which is well off pace. It's in the third quartile. What was your contribution to productivity and where did we go wrong here as well?
This is a real challenge for Scotland. Ambition and productivity, it's the crux. I mean, I think Charlotte did say that there's some, you know, structural aspects to that in our economy. So where Scottish enterprise, so productivity is a blend of many things. It's a blend of innovation and investment. And so if you look at where we are in terms of business innovation, we would need a 200% increase on our innovation levels to get us to the top quartile. That's got a big effect on productivity. We know that companies that export are likely to be more productive because they are competing against best in class. So the fact that we don't have enough exporters plays to that as well. The fact that we have so many micro businesses in our economy, they don't get the scale. So, you know, we do everything we can with companies through things like the Scottish Manufacturing Advisory Service, which works on productivity, our workforce innovation, because treating your employees better, fairer work tends to be more productive. So we're training all of our account managers in that and talking to all the companies about that. The 102 RSC awards that we've made since February last year, all of those companies have signed up to an Invest in Young People plan. That's going to help productivity. And we are going to launch by the end of this year. We have launched productivity plans for the food and drink sector, for tourism and construction. Those are three high employment sectors in Scotland which have significantly lagged behind in productivity. So we're now working with them at a sectoral level, Jackie, to address that. So those are some of the things we're doing, but we're all going to have to work very hard at this.
I wonder whether it's not just a sectoral level, but also at a regional level, because I'm conscious we've had world-class productivity gains in oil and gas as a consequence of the downturn. But if you compare the GVA for Aberdeen as opposed to Glasgow, there's a significant difference there. So I wonder, as well as sectors, whether there isn't a regional approach as well.
So I think the city deal in Glasgow is a great opportunity around the focus on innovation, for example, because we know that leads to greater productivity. The work that we've done with the three Ayrshire councils, where actually we've ended up with more companies into the account management pipeline. That means these companies inherently are more productive. So there's a lot that we can do. I've always said there is no secret sauce in Scottish enterprise. I will give away all of our knowledge, all of our expertise. The taxpayer owns this to anybody who wants to understand and work with us. And we've worked very successfully with some local authorities on the particular local and regional challenges. A factor in productivity is also your ability to connect with, so transport is really important, so the ability to connect with Glasgow or connect with Edinburgh becomes very important. It isn't about taking always productivity opportunities to every part of Scotland. We'll never succeed if that's our mentality.
Okay, and finally, Convener, it doesn't require a response, but I know you do a gender impact analysis of your budget. I wonder whether you could provide that to the committee as we scrutinise the budget when it eventually comes out.
We do that, yes, and I'm very happy to do that. I'm also happy to say that, 56% of my top team is female, 47% of the wider leadership is female, and nearly 60% of our board is female. And, you know, I believe in leading from the front in that regard. And when I became chief executive 7 years ago, I was the only woman on the top team.
Does that mean your gender imbalance is the wrong way in another sense this time?
Pendulums swing all the time, don't they? So I always say, it's really important, really important. I say this to our young graduates, that young men also feel very valued and boys feel very valued too. But let's face the facts, women are underrepresented in the economy and we're 51% of the population. So in simple terms, we're just missing a terrific asset that I want to make sure we exploit.
Yes. The point I was making, perhaps things come and go and it's not always a 50-50 precisely gender balance, but merit and ability also play a part.
So I'm an inherent meritocrat. I get the best people, but encourage everybody to fulfil their potential. When we do that, truly, we will have balanced workplaces anyway.
Yes. Come on to Richard Leonard now.
A specific budgetary point, which I'll come on to in a second, but just on the subject of pendulums and something that John Mason was alluding to earlier on, I mean, do you not get any... Are you not concerned at all with the fact that 34.6% of the Scottish economy is now externally owned, overseas owned, compared to a UK average of 27%? The southwest of England is 20%. The next nearest to us is the West Midlands of England with 30%. Does that not cause you any concern whatsoever?
We can't, on the one hand, say that we're doing brilliantly well in foreign direct investment and that Scotland is a brilliant place with rich assets to exploit, if we're then going to complain that we've got too much foreign ownership. So we have to decide what we are. So it would worry me if those companies were just coming because we were cheap, because they could make a fast buck and go, but they're coming to invest in our assets, our people, our natural resource, our universities. They are a massive contributor to our exports. They are a massive developer of our supply chain. They employ most of our graduates. They, lead from the front. And, they become intrinsically Scottish companies. If you're here in Scotland, you're a Scottish company. And our track record is not that those companies take flight, it's that they continue to invest. So I am not blasé about anything. My job is to maximise the Scottish economy. Would I love it if we had so many global homegrown companies in Scotland that there wasn't room for foreign direct investment? Of course I would, but we have to be realistic. And I think we do very well in high-value jobs. We've seen the highest growth in the UK for high-value jobs and R&D jobs as a result of foreign direct investment. That tells me that that's a terrific investment in the economy, not a fly-by-night investment.
Yeah, but you're a long time in economic development, and you know that the electronics industry, for example, came and went, and a lot of the claims that you've just laid about the current crop of inward investors was attributed to the electronics industry, and that went.
May I challenge you on that? Because I worked for that electronics industry. My first job was in inward investment, as was my sister's, who was in semiconductors. Those came for cheap labour. That's not why foreign direct investment comes to Scotland now. When we were making most of Europe's computers, it was because we were cheaper than other countries. Then Czechoslovakia became cheaper. Then Asia became cheaper. We have moved up the value chain. We've learned a lot. Our first call centres were just to get people a start on the ladder. Now we've got trilingual technical support centres. Now we don't manufacture computers, but we're the heart of software development. IBM has now got several thousand people in software development. Hewlett Packard, that used to manufacture computers, is cybersecurity, software development. So we have moved up the food chain and the value chain considerably through foreign direct investment, and we learned a lot. We gave a lot of people who'd lost their jobs in the industrial decline in Scotland new jobs in the 50s, 60s, 70s and 80s. I've not been around that long, but I have been around since the 80s. So I think that's a valid point you make about that manufacturing environment. And as I say, I worked for two of those companies, but we're significantly up the value chain now in life sciences, in energy, in software, in technology, in financial services. 50% of all of the financial services, the jobs that come to Glasgow, are as a result of US investment. And they're largely there to support, they follow the sun, global investment down to our skills base.
So you don't have any concerns that we're becoming a branch plant economy?
You're trying to pigeonhole me to one or the other, and I don't think that's fair. My job on all of our behalfs is to get the best value for the Scottish economy. And I believe our strategy is that. And I believe that the foreign direct investment that comes to Scotland is very high value and is here to invest in Scotland. So it's not either or. At the same time, we must do everything we can to grow Scottish global firms. I don't want either or. I want both. I want everything for the Scottish economy, for my children, your children. So I think it's unfair to be as black and as white as that.
Okay. Can I move on to another issue in which I'll try not to be black and white, but forgive me if I am. You said earlier on about the importance of supporting local and regional economies. And we've been to California during the course of the last hour, but can I bring us back to Causey Side Street in Paisley? I mean, you are closing the Paisley office, the district office of Scottish Enterprise. And I just wonder whether, and it's opposed, as I understand it, by Renfrewshire Council, the PCS trade union and so on. So I suppose my question is, one, why are you doing that? And is that as a result of the budgetary constraints that you face? And secondly, what are your plans for the other 11 district offices which you have?
So I'll start at the end. We've no plans to close any other offices. And then I'll start at the beginning. PCS supported this as part of our collective bargaining. They then came out and did some stuff with the press, which was unfortunate, but I have all the documentation. We consulted them fully and they supported it early on. This building has got health issues. It's old. We rattle around in it. It's not safe for our staff. It's overly expensive from an energy resource. And not even 6 miles away, we have an office in Clydebank. We have an office in Glasgow. We have lots of space. So we are not cutting any of the resource that we spend in Paisley or Renfrewshire. We are looking to join with our partners, whether it be the Council or Skills Development Scotland or whoever it be, for hot desks, for any staff that are there. Remember, most of our staff don't work from an office. They're out with their customers and out with their clients. So I'm just trying to do what any business would do, be as efficient as possible. No customer will suffer. No client will suffer, no opportunity will be missed. If someone needs a desk in Paisley, we work with one of our partners to get it, and we've got lots of other offices nearby as well. But you know, the building itself is very costly and not safe, and it's my duty of care not to keep it anymore on behalf of the taxpayer and on behalf you know, of our staff. And if we're going to have the attitude where we have to have an office everywhere all the time when we're such a small country, most of our staff now work all over Scotland. They may be just based from one office, but they work all over Scotland. So this, you know, Nick Shields, who is our director of our Scottish Manufacturing Advisory Service, is notionally based from Paisley, but he works all over Scotland all the time. We don't have little boundaries, closed boundaries around parts of Scotland now. We use our talents to work throughout Scotland.
But if that's your approach, why should the people who live around the other 11 offices be confident in their future?
Because I've told them I have no plans to close any other offices. We have got a massive approach to staff engagement. We're one of the few public sector companies in the Sunday Times top 100 places to work for. We care about our staff. We've got Healthy Working Lives Gold. We've got Investors in People Gold. And I've met personally with about 600 staff in the last 3 months on a range of meet Lena sessions, meet our staff, and I've told them we have no plans and I'm not in the habit of telling lies.
Okay.
Thank you. And just to go back to your previous point, and I'll try not to ask a pendulum question, is your point that Scottish companies abroad or indeed foreign companies investing here, there can be mutual benefit? So it's not a simple matter of a company coming from abroad and taking from Scotland or a Scottish company doing the same abroad, but in fact trade and these sorts of things can be of mutual benefit to countries depending on how companies conduct themselves.
Yes, and ultimately, I think my only point is that we're in a global economy. So I don't want to appear that I'm relaxed, you know, about anything, that I don't care. You know, the job is if you anchor investment in Scotland, then it, because of our assets, it's less likely to go. Also, let's remember there are a number of Scottish companies that have faced the wall in the last year, and an overseas buyer has come in, injected capital, and helped them stay and helped the jobs stay as well.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Convener. Earlier on, you said that despite the lower budget, you have achieved more. But one of the submissions to Enterprise Reviews from Mackay Consultants said that I believe Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise have generally made very good use of their budgets, but their contributions to Scotland's economic performance have declined recently. And I'm just wondering if that was your view and if what the reasons would that be for?
I don't hold that view. I mean, I do realise that I have a job that most people have an opinion for, and many people think they could make a better fist of it. So, I welcome, you know, there was a lot of opinions given in that. But, you know, the facts remain that, I said earlier on, Scottish Enterprise has helped create over the last, 4 years or so, 55,000 jobs. Our investment, for every pound we've invested, we generate about £9 back. And the Audit Scotland review said that we are very good value for money, governed well, and have a transparent and serious impact on the economy. But I welcome any challenge on how to do it better, any data, any evidence, you know, if there's a better way to do it, and I don't know it, I would be very willing to look at it.
And in terms of the 55,000 jobs you mentioned, and also the fact that there's been a growth in export sales, another comment from a different organisation said that the model adopted for grant-based funding is one based on number of jobs as opposed to amount of investment. For capital investment processes such as agricultural chemicals productions, this is a disadvantage, even though the amount of export sales is considerable. So is that competing demands, and if so, what takes priority?
So what I don't know is specifically who that was from and what kind of grants they were talking about. So our innovation grants would be around the kind of things that you talked about. RSA, Regional Selective Assistance, which is a European grant, is obviously jobs-based. So it depends on you know, what we were talking about. The one thing that I want to do is make sure that our grants process is as least cumbersome as possible, as transparent and easy. So we're doing a lot of work with customers to make that faster, more digital. But I'm happy to talk to you, but I don't know the specific grant. But if it was RSA, then that is jobs outcome, and that's a European issue.
In terms of growing the Scottish economy, what research is carried out by Scottish Enterprise in order to identify where the growth areas are and where you should be putting that level of support in?
Well, we've got 85 people not in Scotland and around the world, and we use them a great deal for intelligence. We connect with our universities all over the world. We use our Global Scots. We have a world-class economics research and evaluation team, and we work with all of the growth sectors on a plan for each sector that identifies global opportunities. It's no point just identifying global opportunities. We have to understand what Scottish assets we have that we can exploit. And our job is to find disproportionate growth in the world and match it to a Scottish asset and then exploit the heck out of it.
Again, another contribution said, and this is in relation to support to make it simpler and clearer and help deliver Scotland's vision. It says, I rarely see Scottish Enterprise or other agencies leveraging best-in-class techniques used in other places or published studies on enterprise and skill support. Instead, I see all these agencies to be too keen to commission their own novel research, which generally involves asking, relatively speaking, non-experts for their opinions rather than evidence-based analysis. And given the pressure on your budget, is that a fair criticism?
I don't know, because I don't know who it was from. Was it anonymous? What was the detail?
Toshiba Medical.
There was 600 and odd opinions given to that. So my attitude would be to sit and meet with anybody that had a better, you know, way of doing that. We don't spend a lot of money on other experts, and we've got our own evaluation team. I'm quite obsessed with evidence because it's often the only thing I have to explain why we do one thing and not another. And if you bring it back to the GVA, what's the gross value add to the economy? That leads Scottish Enterprise to make our investments. But, you know, if someone doesn't get money from us, then I can understand sometimes they understandably get annoyed at that. But I would be happy to improve, but I don't recognise it as a theme that other customers tell us.
Right. Okay, thanks so much.
Right, well, thank you very much to both of our witnesses, Dr. Lena Wilson and Ian Scott. Thank you very much for coming in today. And I'm not sure of the correct word, move into private session now. So I'd ask those in the public gallery to leave at this point. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.